Okay, I had too much to drink. I don't think I'ma make it home. I wanna fall asleep and get to the crib, get stoned, make something to eat.
What's going on, guys? Ben McCann here. Just put the boat in the water, as you can see. I didn't film any of pre-fishing, so I guess this will just be the intro. I've been up here in Plattsburgh, New York for this Toyota for, I don't know, several days now, like over a week, I think. I got here, I think, last Tuesday or Wednesday, and this tournament, this Toyota, starts tomorrow, which is Thursday, so over a week. I've been up here pre-fishing, snooping around, trying to get the lay of the land. I've never fished a northern lake, and I've never been here, and I've never really done much smallmouth fishing, so I've done a lot of learning. And picked up some cool things and tried a bunch of things and implemented old stuff or new stuff, and kind of found a bunch of fish. From what I understand about this fishery, is it's got plenty of fish to go around, supposedly. I'm assuming, kind of from what I've heard and seen from past tournament results, it looks like everybody's gonna weigh a good sized bag. So my goal is to try and weigh 17 or 18 plus a day. It will be difficult for me, I will say, because I have multiple areas that are holding those fish, but they are kind of getting the 3+ pound class fish and 4 pound class fish to eat, and just bumping into them has been difficult. So they're around. I've seen a lot of them. I've caught a few. I've hooked some. I've the whole nine yards. So they're around. It'll just be a little tricky to put five of them in the boat each day, five of the better class fish out of all the fish I've been catching. So it's doable, but it'll be a little tricky. Got the boat in the water. Like I said, we're gonna go check some things out that way. I found some bedding fish all in this bay. This is actually the bay that I fished when I first came here, and I caught like over 18 pounds in this bay first day I came. Caught like 18 and change, had two over four. And then the past days since, I've caught all sorts of fish, but just nothing huge. One smallmouth, almost five. Hooked, caught, and lost some real nice largemouth. Seen some real nice largemouth. Caught some real nice largemouth. So, learned a lot. Can't wait to put it into practice tomorrow and see how it works. Today's our last practice day, so I'm just going to go around, check a few things, expand on a few areas real quick. Got till 4:30. It's 11:22. So dead middle of the day, but I'm just gonna go peek on a few bedfish, try and find a few more that are the right size. Hopefully I can just pick up a few nice ones early in the morning, and then start doing the blind fishing stuff. Grass edges, grass fields, over rock, rock flats, all sorts of those things will be my next tactics. And then shallow fishing. I got docks, I've got grass flats, just shorelines, weed beds, everything to grass fish shallow and hopefully bump into some largemouth. So I'm also gonna go check that today and see if those are still around, because day one was actually surprisingly, it was either day one or day two. Day one and day two were like some of my most phenomenal days. I physically put my eyes on a bunch of fish on day one, and I caught a bunch of fish on day one. And then day two, I ran, got a competitor right there, so just give me a sec. But day two, I ran north on the lake, and I found a teeny grass cove with, like 75 yards or so of productive water, or less. But it had a ton of largemouth in it. Like I probably saw 50 or more largemouth in that area. It was kind of insane, and I was like, holy cow. This is what this lake is like. It was the first grass bed I pulled up to, and it's a teeny cove, hidden, tucked away, one little cove, and I fished a ton of grass since, and that was the best I've found, period. Highest concentration of fish, but I haven't been back there in over a week, so I need to check that out, check a few other things out. We got a bunch of rods to rig. I made a big list of things on my phone I need to get done before tomorrow. I already did some other prep work, and as you can see, I don't even have my front graphs undone. I'm also supposed to go pick up a UPS package because my front graph mount broke. I fixed it, but it snapped both sides off. My graph fell off on the deck while I was running one day in rough water here. But so anyways, a lot's gone on, a lot's happened, but hopefully we can go catch them up come tomorrow. I'm gonna go check a few more things, and yeah, hopefully we do well. Well, we got our pairings for tomorrow. We're boat number 10, and I'm also paired with a dude named Ben. So Ben, two Bens, number 10, kind of cool. Means we'll have an early day tomorrow. I'll be back in at 2, which is kind of short. But tomorrow on the forecast is supposed to be better, more sunny, cleaner weather, so a better day for bed fishing. So kind of happy with that. And then that also means I'd rather have a, I definitely would rather have a later day, day 2, than I would a shorter day. So that just means I'll be able to expand and learn or whatever on whatever happens day 1, especially after looking at results for day 1 and however everything shakes out, then I know what to do for the next day and I have a lot more time to do it. So hopefully that works out nicely, but I am right off the rip for tomorrow morning. So takeoff's like at 6, we're due back in at 2. I have a big laundry list of crap I've been getting together. Still got to rig a bunch of rods. I re-spooled some stuff last night. I was up till 2 in the morning. Got the boat on the charger. Got to get some camera gear together. That means you. I couldn't find treble hooks. Got all sorts of other stuff, though. Yeah, got my list of things. I do that all the time. If you don't, it's a really great idea to help you keep track of all your things that you need to do when you get off the water. This is a different day. You get off the water, or when you're on the water, you think of, oh crap, I gotta do all these things when I get off the water. Write it down. And then you can knock it off, cross it off real quick. Doesn't matter what it's for, what trip it's for, whatever. Do that all the time. So, helps you get stuff done. Helps me get stuff done. But hopefully tomorrow goes well. I'm gonna try and film the whole day. I do need to focus on fishing though, because I don't have a crazy long day, but we're eating some food right now. Fine, taking a break, got off the water, and we caught another 3-pounder today and hooked like 3 more 3-pounders. And then hooked a good fish on a drop shot that came off, but I still haven't swapped out my jerkbait hooks, and I've been at it for like a week now, and they're a little. So I think that's kind of why I'm losing fish. Recently I hadn't been losing fish like the whole trip, and then like the past 2 days I've lost like a bunch of fish. So hopefully I'm just getting it out of the way before a tournament. I'm gonna try and get my head in the game tomorrow, do well, try and catch, goal is 16 plus. If we can catch 16 plus, I'd be real happy. I did have like a 3 to 4 pound largemouth today that I saw on a bed, and another one on a bed that I found when I went back and checked that area, and sure enough one of them got locked in the bed, and it was like almost 3-4 pounder. And I pitched a Senko to it. It was a little finicky, but then it got on the bed. Pitched a Senko, kind of swam off the bed, came back, it saw it on the bed. I twitched it up, just in the middle of the water column. The fish swam up to it, and I pulled it away from it, put it back in. And he swam up to it again, and he opened his mouth, and I pulled to keep it out of his mouth. But he went to suck it in, so I was like, sweet. And then left. So the fish was fired up. The areas I was hoping to find fish in were all good. Everything was solid. So I feel good about tomorrow. I just got to go catch them and hopefully don't lose a bunch of fish and fish clean. The jerkbait thing, I've been losing some fish though, because they're, when it's clear and hot and calm, they come up to it and they just nose under it. And they're like barely suck it in, and then they turn down real quick. So they get like one hook in them or something. And it's a little, but some of them get hooked real well. So hopefully tomorrow goes well, and we're going to get some sleep, finish our chores for the day, and go fish. Fixing to get things started here on Champlain. While running rough water, my camera actually somehow got turned off.
I think the battery jiggle free. And so when I restarted it, I lost audio. So I'm gonna do a voiceover for the start of my day one. But I started by fishing down a dock stretch and shoreline looking for post-spawn fish to fish up to a 4-pound bed fish I found. So this is the 4-pound bed fish. Pitched a couple things to him right off the bat that he didn't react to, and then he bit a tube and took the tail off a couple drop shot baits, and then finally pitched in there with the drop shot and he picked it up and swam off with it. But that was my first fish I actually caught of the tournament, 4-pounder, which kind of got rid of the nerves for a minute. And then I started covering some more water on another stretch, looking for post spawn fish and working up to another area of a few bed fish that I'd found. That clip is actually of me doing that jerkbait technique I'll talk about at the end of the video, which was just slightly different but was working great for post spawning fish on just like rock flats and stuff outside of the spawning areas. Actually, there was a camera boat that pulled in while I was fishing, following a different competitor, and I caught that fish right in front of him, and that's kind of why you can see me holding it up there. But he snagged a couple really cool picks, and I'd never had camera picks from a camera boat before, so I thought that was really cool. But that was my second 3-pounder, and that was like the next actual keeper fish I caught. So I had 2 3-plus-pounders like right off the bat. As you can see, there was a competitor on the same stretch, so once I got down to here, I was kind of just buzzing through it and then fixing to leave and go largemouth fish. Sure enough, I got bit off of a shallower part of the flat. That part of the flat I think was only like 4 or 5 foot versus the 8 or so feet I'd been casting to. But hooked that fish, fought him to the boat doing that same jerkbait technique, get him in the boat, and it's another 3 or so pound smallmouth. I believe the first one was 4, the second one I think was right on 3. I think that one was a 320. So after catching that fish, I was like, all right, I got a nice start. I need to go hunt down some bigger largemouth, because at that point it was right away and I had a whole rest of the day to do it. So I got to my largemouth flat where I'd seen a big largemouth the day before and seen some really nice largemouth on my second day of pre-fishing, like when I first got there. So I fish around, I get up to the bed, I'm looking for the fish, I can't find him. I start to get a little worried he's not there, but I keep my head in the game and I'm like, he's probably still roaming around in this flat somewhere. So after kind of snooping around and looking for a bit, I get my eyes on the fish and then I announce to my co, hey, I see the big largemouth. And then I also pitched to him, got him to eat it, and then let my co-angler know, hey, I got him, he's on, before I even set the hook. Set the hook on the fish, fought him, and was really, really worried, and very, very anxious that this fish was going to wrap me up in some grass and some reeds and break me off, or something was going to go wrong hooking that big of a fish in grass. So I was really, really worried, and plus, since I sight fished the fish and I'd been thinking about the fish for over a day, when I actually put my eyes on it, my adrenaline just went through the roof and I was literally shaking after I caught that fish. But fish went over 4.5 pounds, bigger than I thought, put him in the well, and just an incredible start. So kept fishing around, ended up sight fishing a few more largemouth off the same flat. What they were doing was kind of using the heat, getting up right on the surface and using the heat to warm them up. I think they were sunning because the water was really cold, but found a few more, pitched a Senko to this guy. He picked that up right away, and then put him in the well. Another, I think, nice high two there. Fish into a marina that I hadn't checked before in pre-fishing and said, why not give this a go? I'm kind of got a little ahead of the curve than what I thought I was going to be, catching fish a little quicker than I thought. So went in that marina, caught that fish, which was actually spawning on top of a stump, and then said, all right, time to bounce, and made a move to another dock that I'd found in pre-fishing. And this dock in pre-fishing actually had like 5+ largemouth suspended underneath of it when I fished it in pre-fishing, and I caught a lot of fish off it, but none of them were big. And the hope I had was hoping, okay, maybe fish cycling in and out, hopefully another chain of hopefully better sized fish will come in. So I pull up to this dock expecting to get bit. First cast I get underneath the dock, as you can see, I just kind of make that cast, sort of just dead stick it and leave it under there, and sure enough, get bit on the first cast underneath the dock. Kind of help walk that fish out of the dock. Just for reference, if you have a fish and he's heading towards a piling, you know, you flip a rod tip the other way. And so when I'm dog fishing like that, especially on a lighter line, I get really anxious and worried about that happening. So I kind of walk that fish out of that dock, get him out in the open, and then when he gets closer, he's a little bigger than I thought, because I caught a lot of smaller fish off that dock in pre-fishing. Numbers, but smaller. So I didn't expect him to be that big, but when he got closer to the boat, I was like, oh my god, I need a net. So got him netted. I believe that one was a nice high 3. He called out that 2 2¾-pounder or so that I'd caught sight fishing, sunning on that grass flat, and then got rigged up with an Senko, prepared to make another cast, and then the actual next cast, I got to actually go underneath the dock because there was a decent bit of waves. I get underneath there, check my weight, and as you can see, kind of what I've been doing was just dead sticking it. So I go to feel after it's just been sitting there. Sure enough, I'm bit again. The fish is swimming to the left, set the hook to the right to pull him out. He darts to the right, so I swing my rod tip to the left and pull the fish sort of right out of the dock and kind of just walk him out. He didn't look as big to me, so I wasn't really worried about it. I grabbed the net myself and prepared to net the fish when he got close to the boat. One thing I will say is that Ballistic 2500 Series MQ handled a lot of larger fish really, really well for being such a small reel, and also that PAL diesel 721, I believe it is, diesel, or 732 diesel, handles those fish really well. So that was another high three. He called out a 3-pound smallmouth, and then next dock, caught this dude. Another good one, we got over 18. I'm trying to keep calling. Second biggest, number 5. That's a bag.
What number?
10.
Let's go ahead and make
the establish
one. We don't have a pro side big bass yet. Let's get one. Yeah, man. Got a slot somewhere.
That's what I'm talking about. How big is that big?
Over 4. About 4.5.
Let's see.
5 and 5.
Big bag. I got 3 pounds, 11 ounces on the big fish. Now we
got a start. Big bass bill.
That's good. You're the man.
Yeah.
Here's the big bass man, Ben McCann. Brandon Florida Pro, 5 bass in the bag, our third 19 plus pound bag, 19 pounds, 4 ounces a day, 1 bass. We'll have another big bass. I got a feeling I heard the Berkeley big bass bell. Let's see what he's got. There it is. About a big large now. Mixed bag. Take your pick. There you go. Going to weigh a large now. The bass is going to weigh 4 pounds and 8 ounces, 4.8 on your kicker. Good job. Raise the bar on the big bass. Both those tickets are yours.
Thanks, boss.
Good job, man. Big one, man. I'll tell you. Take it on the time. Here we go. Take it on to the time.
We got off the water today. We're done. We're done with day one. I think we're where we need to be to make the top 25 cut at least.
We just gotta do it again, and that's the hard part. Because I kind of burned everything to the ground today that I'd found in pre-fishing, but it'll be what it's gonna be. We're gonna go fish hard tomorrow. I do get to have a longer day since I was first flight, which is beautiful. And hopefully it works out. We're gonna go give it a go, and gonna get some Five Guys first though, because I'm starving. I gotta rig a bunch of stuff, and I blew up like 3 setups today, so I gotta rework a bunch of crap and re-spool some rods and junk. But hoorah, day one is survived. Beautiful day two here on Plattsburgh. We're fixing to go get after it. Hopefully we do well. I marked a bunch of new stuff last night, looking at Google Maps and stuff, and I put it on my graph as waypoints to check, because I burned a lot of my water yesterday. There was things I saved, but not a lot. Built a great bag yesterday, but it'll be really hard to do it again today, just because two of my biggest fish I caught, I knew they were both there, and I went straight to them. The other three I just caught fishing, so who knows. But 4+ pound fish have been very hard to come by, and I caught two of them yesterday by having one on a bed and one that was supposed to be on a bed but was just cruising in that area too. I caught it not on the bed, but probably 40 or 50 feet away from the bed, just cruising. Same fish though, largemouth, and that was a 4.5 pounder, and that's the biggest largemouth I've caught all week, so it'd be really hard to duplicate that. But I'm hoping maybe I can catch multiple high 3 pounders and come close. Maybe one lucky 4. We'll see.
Oh, that's right, you're from Florida.
Whatever, he's touching that.
Yeah.
Man. Oh. Oh, shit.
It's a fish. That's a
call. You got him. Thank you.
wrap for day two. It's tough. We caught a lot of fish right at the end, culled a bunch right at the end, and had fun, but it was a rough day. Kind of saw that coming. I knew it was going to be difficult to catch what I caught, and thankfully we were able to kind of pull it together right at the end of the day, and hopefully we cash a check, but we shall see. All right, we're fixing away in our best five. We're going to pull them out of the well here. If we can get this guy to run. Look at that. All right, here we go. I'm all good. I'm just taking a video of that. Thank you though.
Catch him again?
Number 2, 16. For anybody wondering who that was Garrett Rockmora. Dude's a legend. Florida guy, go ball him. That's number 3. And we got our 2 bigs here. We're gonna pull out for that.
Where
are you going? Where are you going now?
Oh!
Are you?
Oh!
We're
going to,
There you have it. There are 2 big fish.
Ba-bing, ba-boom. Yeah.
You got you a big one, too.
I got one, not too bad. Thanks for making me feel better. Think you'll let me hold 2 up?
Yeah.
5 and 5. Good job, bro.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Good job. Here we go, man. Bibbacan, Bradenton, Florida Pro. 19.4 on day 1, 5 more today, looking for 17.8s. Got you a 16.10 in check range, 35.14. Yep, give us a picture too, Charles. That Polaroid about out of film yet, Charles?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, brother. He told me that. Yeah, 16.15, baby.
That's a wrap on Lake Champlain. We're gonna hold up our best 2 one more time, and that'll be all. Our best 2. They in there? Heads and tails? You're the man. Thanks, Paul.
Hey, no problem, brother.
What's going on, guys? Ben McCann here. We just wrapped up the Lake Champlain Toyota. Today was day 2. Day 1, we had like 19.4, I think. 19.4 day 1, day 2 is 16.10, overall was 35.14. For some reason the MLF app hasn't loaded the standings for me yet, but I'm like, I think 30 something, mid to late 30s. We got a nice check for $2,130. Great week of fishing here in Lake Champlain. I've never been up north before. I've been to New York one time, a hot minute ago, but I never fished or anything. So I've never even been here, never done like smallmouth fishing mainly. And so just a really neat experience and great trip. I did catch fish on all sorts of different setups throughout the week. And I had a blast all week long, but I'm gonna show you my main 4 setups that really played for me, especially in the tournament. Actually leading up to the tournament, some of them were a main staple. One I never even fished in like 10 years until today. And then the other one I kind of started mainly keying in the tournament. I did use it pre-fishing, but I didn't catch any giants pre-fishing with it. So I'm going to show you my 4 setups that I used this week and kind of give you a little rundown on how I did my damage. So I'll just show you all 4 first. These were keep in mind the best four that I used in the event, as you can tell, main theme is PAL rods, because they're bad to the bone, they catch big fish, and I did not miss a single fish that would have helped me in 2 days of tournament fishing. Every single fish came in the boat, every single one of them. There wasn't one fish I missed that was of any size, I nothing memorable. So if you can fish 2 days of a tournament that clean, I ain't got nothing to complain about, and I think your gear's spot on. So these PALs have been awesome for me, and I'm just going to kind of give you a quick rundown on the setups I use. So one of the main setups I used to cover water here on Champlain was this Rapala jerkbait. It's like a shallow diving jerkbait. I had it spooled up with 12-pound Seaguar Red Label on a Daiwa SB Tatula, just 7-1. And it's a Powell rod 7-2-4. This is a great jerkbait rod, or like treble hook bait rod, for when you want a little more distance, because it's 7-2. So if you want to be able to cast something a little farther and have a little bit of a longer rod, this is a great hard bait rod for that, but it's super soft, so I didn't have to worry about pulling off smallmouth and stuff like that when fish were slapping at it. With this rod, it was absolutely phenomenal for me all week long. I caught a lot of 3-plus-pound fish, a lot of fish on 4 or close to 4 on this setup, and just had a ball with it. And like I said, I would cover water with this. This is what I'd use if I'm pulling up to a flat, a point, a grass field, chunk rock, whatever. This is what I was fishing over it to cover water, and it worked great. The retrieve I was doing, I think with normal like jerk baits and stuff, you watch guys sit there and twitch it with a rod tip down, pause, twitch, twitch, pause, twitch, pause, twitch, twitch, and then they'll load up on the fish. I was doing a little bit of a different technique, and the reason I was doing that is because at the start of my pre-fishing time, I pre-fished pretty close to the ramp, and when I caught like one of my first fish, which happened to be a post-spawn 3-plus-pound smallmouth, it got close to the boat and spit up alewife. I didn't really know the name of them, but it's essentially just a big shad that lives on Lake Champlain, from my understanding. A shad roughly the size of my jerkbait. So after seeing him spit up that alewife, I said, well, what do I have that'll mimic an alewife? Somewhat similar profile, very close in color, was that jerkbait. I did play around with deep diving jerkbaits, shallow diving jerkbaits like this one, different colors, all sorts of stuff, different sizes. And everything I used, this was the best, and I think it was because it closely matched the color of an alewife, although it doesn't have chartreuse or anything like that, which apparently smallmouth love. They were smashing it. Even when the sun was out, bright middle of the day, even broad, like calm, just sun, they would still come up and hit it, and big smallmouth too. I upgraded that with size 6 Gamagatsu treble hooks, by the way, and that I think really helped my hookup ratio and helped me land fish. But yeah. My retrieve, I'd cast it out there, let it hit the surface, and the alewife I noticed, or at least smallmouth, that were sitting in roughly like anywhere from 4 to 12 feet of water, would rather, I felt like, come up to hit a jerkbait than they would hit a deep diving jerkbait at their depth. That's what I noticed. I fished a deep diving jerkbait for a long couple days up here, played around with different jerkbaits. This was the one that got bit the best, and it got bit closest to the surface. So to keep it up in the water column, and draw those fish up, because I think they see it from a distance and think it's an alewife, zip it along the surface, they'll rock it up and they'll blast it. So I would sit there and I'd work my rod tip up like this. I'd pop it, I'd wait, I'd pop, pop, I'd wait, pop. And then, just key was kind of long pauses if it's calm. If fish are real fired up, you could go a little quicker. And then suddenly you just go to pop and there's weight, catch a fish. And that's how I caught 2 3-plus-pound smallmouth to start up the tournament on day one, was with that jerkbait and that technique over shallow rock flats, out past where smallmouth were spawning. Because when I first came into the bay, found a bunch of shallow fish spawning. When I started pre-fishing, caught a bunch of shallow fish spawning. But what I noticed was I felt like they were pulling off, or at least there was more fish I'd see cruising when I started patrolling the shorelines. So I started standing off and then casting out in the open for patrolling fish and scanning with active target, looking for singular or pairs of fish on a boulder or something like that, or some more aggressive rock, and I cast out to the with this and catch them. So that was one of my main setups. That's kind of what I did with it, and that's what worked. Worked really, really well, by the way, especially for covering water. Setup number 2 that I'm going to go into. This was a great setup for getting finicky fish to bite, fish you pass with the boat to bite, finicky largemouth to bite, and just big smallmouth. I caught my biggest, actually, bass of the week on a drop shot. Wasn't in the tournament, but I got my biggest bass of the week on a Berkeley flatworm. When I first got up here, I didn't really believe the hype. I thought it was a little overkill with the flatworm stuff and just wasn't all that crazy impressed with a flatworm. And plus, I've had not the best experiences with, like, whatever they call it, power bait stuff from Berkeley in the past. So I wasn't super excited to give a flatworm a try. But after a couple days of playing around with Yum drop shots and all sorts of different brands, I picked up a flatworm and I started catching a lot of fish and having a lot more fish actually bite it and hold it. I also haven't fished a drop shot a ton, but this is kind of how I had it set up. I just had it set up with a snail knot. I don't know if a lot of guys do that, but I found that to work really good for me. With 12-pound Seaguar, Red Label, leader, and then I had that tied to 15-pound just Daiwa J braid, and it worked great. I also had it on the new Daiwa Tatula MQ spinning reel on a Power Rods, I think it's 732 spinning rod. This worked great for my drop shots. I didn't lose any key fish. My hookup ratio was great with the drop shot. I had a Gamagatsu, I think it's a size 1/0, like Aaron Martin's, one of those signature series drop shot hooks. Thing was killer. Got a lot of great fish, it actually caught my 4-pound smallmouth day one on a bed. It caught a largemouth on day two on a bed that I saw right at the end of the day, which helped me cull up to my 16-something pounds and get in check range, secure that spot. Those are kind of the two most memorable catches with that, other than almost a 5-pound smallmouth and pre-fishing on it, and all sorts of other good smallmouth and pre-fishing. The key to the drop shot for me, I feel like when I've seen videos of people fishing drop shot, when I feel like you see a lot of people sit there and they'll shake it and stuff. That wasn't working well for me. I tried doing that to bedding fish. I tried doing that to fish I saw cruising. Didn't work that well. The thing that worked the best for me and actually working all my soft plastics this week was almost dead sticking it. I'd cast it out there. I'd sort of hold it on a taut line so it would fall like this to the bottom. It would fall like that all the way to the bottom, and it would glide. And if I held it on kind of a taut line, it would glide like that all the way to the bottom, and the bait would be the presentation of the bait would be much better than casting it, letting it hit the water and fall straight down. What would happen is the drop shot would spin all the way to the bottom and then hit the bottom and fall around. And I didn't feel like it worked very naturally. And I got way more bites when I cast, and I let it glide down to the bottom, it touched the bottom, and then what I'd start to do, instead of shake it or drop it or whatever, is once it hit the bottom, I'd let it fall dead slack, and the bait would fall to the bottom. And then I'd slowly, after a couple seconds of kind of just dead sticking it, I'd lift my rod to begin gaining tension, pull, I'd feel the weight leave the bottom, I'd pull up, and then I'd let it fall, and I'd just hop it along, essentially. And then when it hit the bottom again, I'd drop my rod to it. That actually caught me my most fish this week. Bed fish, everything, that's how it worked the best. Casting it deep on like rock and all sorts of stuff around grass, that's what worked the best for me. I was visibly watching largemouth and smallmouth in shallow water that I was casting doing this. They would not react to much other than that retrieve for me. So that's kind of what I was doing. That was my setup. Just tied a uni to uni knot, and this whole combo was perfect. Didn't lose hardly any, if any, fish like the entire week on that setup. Kind of going into the bread and butter, which I wasn't expecting to be the biggest player for me, ended up being the biggest player for me. It caught me my two biggest fish each day, both 4.5 or so pound largemouth. Day one, I think, was a 4-pound 8-ounce, so 4.5. And day two, I think, was also right in that 4-pound 4.5-pound range, largemouth. And that came both on the same technique, which was a rig Senko. Funny story on how I was, what colors and whatnot I was fishing, but the Senko setup ended up being a huge key for me. I caught my 4.5-pound fish day one, which was my kicker, and then I had my 4-pound bed smallmouth, and then three more mid to high 3-pounders that I caught all skipping docks with this Senko setup. So day one, 4 of my 5 fish. So the absolute meat of my weight came catching largemouth, and it came skipping this Senko with this Senko setup. Day two, I also caught my biggest largemouth on this setup, and I believe I also caught one or two more largemouth on the setup. I believe it was two, one or two. But Point being, this worked great for me throughout the week, especially for shallow largemouth and convincing really finicky fish to bite. Just break down the setup real quick. This isn't even a crazy expensive rod. If you don't have one, you should go get yourself one. This is the Powell Diesel. I believe this is an also 712. Works great for wacky rigs. I also used it in grass. I have two of these setups. I used the other one in grass with a weedless drop shot to catch largemouth early in the week in pre-fishing, and it works great. Killer blank, and setup was flawless. I did not miss a single fish on this wacky rig setup in the entire tournament, and I don't think I missed much at all, if any, in pre-fishing. Instead of using 12, I used 12 to shallow largemouth fish in pre-fishing, and I broke off like two different times on big largemouth. So I opted in the tournament to jump up to 15. I feel like a lot of people get a little line shy and say, I don't know if those largemouth will still bite. The way I view it is, in a tournament, you're wanting to boat as the highest percentage of the fish you hook as possible to maintain your, one, mental throughout the day, so you're not losing fish and feeling, and also you can horse fish and get into the boat a lot quicker and land more fish and everything throughout the day much quicker, safer, everything, by using a little heavier line if you can get away with it. I felt like the fish didn't care, so that's why I went with 15 over 12. So I jumped up to 15 pound leader on this instead of like the 12 I had on my drop shot rod. I felt like I could force those largemouth out of docks a lot better. And the reason I did go heavier is, like I said, you just get a higher landing percentage. In practice, I caught a almost 4 pound largemouth post bomb underneath a dock on 12, and it was wrapped around pilings. It was wrapped through the boat lift and then around pilings, and somehow I didn't break it off. But when I got back out, that 12 was absolutely chafed, and I decided after that, you know what, I don't want to play around with 12 in a dock. If I hook a 5 tournament day and I break off on a 5, I'm going to absolutely lose my mind. So I jumped up to 15, I didn't regret it one bit, and I caught a bunch of great fish thanks to using that 15. Today, after breaking off what was, I believe, a wacky something from Owner hook, I only bought one pack of those. I found them at like, whatever it's called, L.O. Bean or some store up here. And after breaking off and using all, I didn't actually break them off, after exploding all of those, and I think I broke actually one off on a dock or something, but after breaking all four of those hooks that came in the pack, I opted to go to that Aaron Martin's drop shot style hook today, and I caught my 4 or something on that hook, but also the Owner like cover wacky or whatever it was, worked great. Trying to think, what else? Retrieve, very, like I said, almost dead sticking it. If I'd skip it under dock, I'd skip it under there, get as far up under there as possible, leave it. Drop my rod tip, just let it lay slack. Especially the docks, I was seeing a lot of bait. If I was seeing a bunch of bluegill suspended or largemouth like in practice when it was hot in the afternoons, I would literally see the largemouth suspended roughly, you know, an inch or two underneath the surface sitting on the docks. A couple of them, 2 or 3 of them, if it was a good dock. I could skip it under there, just let it lay. Eventually, to catch their attention, they'd say, why not, easy meal, they'd swim over to it and pick it up. As to the color I was fishing, I started out fishing a green pumpkin color in practice, and what I noticed was I wasn't catching as many fish. I saw a lot of fish turn away from it and whatnot, and when I was using chartreuse colors, when I first started fishing on the beds and stuff, chartreuse seemed to get the fish's attention a little better here. And then while I was at Dick's Sporting Goods, the reason is kind of a funny story, is I went to Dick's Sporting Goods, I was picking up Senkos and whatnot, and I just happened to pass the Dick's Sporting Goods grab bin. And this color caught my eye. It's a chartreuse and green pumpkin big bite bait Senko, which was going on sale at Bass Pro, and they were getting rid of them. And so I saw like four packs almost right away, just spread out in the bins. I grabbed like 3 or 4 of those packs, and then I came out and fished with them, and they worked great. The fish seemed to react way better to the chartreuse and green pumpkin color, and then that was also what I caught all 4 of my fish on day one. For my largemouth on day one. So I raced back to Dick's Sporting Goods, bought as many as I could, and topped up my yum bag that I had with that color. And that color right there was killer. As you can see, it's like a mixed chartreuse and green pumpkin. There's really nothing special about it. I was also pumping this yum scent into them, the bag. And I let them soak in that just to try and help fish hold on to it the whole 9 yards, and it worked great. Like I said, it was dead sticking, cast under there, let it sit. Fish should pick it up, close the bail, just reel and pull. Reel and pull to prevent breaking off, especially if you knew they were wrapped around a piling. Just reel and pull. Real nice and light. Caught every fish that I set the hook on in the tournament on this, and it worked great. The reel, I opted for a 25,000 versus This is the 3000, slightly larger, different style handle. As you can tell, it's like a got like a T handle. This is a 2500 series ballistic MQLT from Daiwa, also killer reel. I bought these and those new Tatula MQs myself when I came up here, so I could have them on my new PAL blanks for this trip, because I knew I'd probably use them, and sure enough I did. But I intentionally bought a 2500 for this setup because it's one of my lighter setups, and I knew on a lighter setup I'd be able to skip docks a little easier. It's smaller, more agile, it's more finessey, and I felt like I'd be able to target cast and stuff with it a lot better, and sure enough it works great. It's split up with 15 pound Daiwa J braid again, and then just a 15 pound leader with a uni to uni knot. Killer setup, worked great, caught a ton of weight this week. Last combo I'm gonna show you that played in the tournament for me today, after seeing some smallmouth and whatnot and pitching to a smallmouth on the bed day one with a tube, actually. This funny story behind the tube is, in practice, I caught a smallmouth with a tube and an EWG hook in his throat. Broken off, but in his throat, and he spit it up when he got in the boat. I was like, holy cow. And it just kind of gave me confidence in the tube and kind of brought it up to my attention. Hey, try a tube. So while I was in the Dick's Sporting Goods and whatnot up here getting tackle, I decided to pick up some tubes. So I picked up some tubes, one, because I haven't used tubes in a long time. I didn't have them in my tackle arsenal. I felt like it was a great thing to have. And two, because I felt like the fish here were going to eat them. Sure enough, put up to the bed day one for that 4 pound smile. This is one of the things I pitched to it. It actually picked it up, swam off the bed with it, dropped it, and then I set the hook after it dropped it, because I thought the fish still had it. But in between him swimming and me dropping my rod to the swing, he dropped it. And there was a pipe right next to him, because you set up on one of like the drain pipes or the water filter pipes or whatever that comes down from the houses on the shorelines here. I set the hook, got it hung in the pipe, and I didn't want to go retrieve the tube off the bed. And so I broke it off. But after day one, I made sure to have a new one rigged up on deck today. And I had a fish miss a walking topwater bait. And pitched this over there and caught a 3.5 pound smallmouth to start my day. That was my big fish, second biggest fish of the day, and my biggest smallmouth of day two was caught on a tube. I haven't fished a tube much. I haven't fished a tube in like 10 years, literally since I was in like middle school. I'm 22 now, but it just seemed relevant. I also saw smallmouth spitting up a lot of crawfish, so I said, you know what, I'm gonna fish a tube. Although I don't know a bunch about a tube and how to fish a tube properly in the whole nine yards, I do know what largemouth, smallmouth bass, and the whole nine yards like to react to. And I do know what style blanks to use on a open hook bait. So I just use what I normally use. It's a Power Rod 764. It's like my Carolina rig, Texas rig rod, but a little softer. It's also a killer walking topwater bait, rod bait. That's what I use for my walking topwaters. And this blank is great for any slightly finessier heavy techniques, which an open hook, which I can swing on. I'm gonna put that on a beefier stick one, because if I hook the fish, I can just swing on them, stick them to the boat, and not worry about it. So that's kind of why I chose that blank to stick this on. It's also got 20 pound Seaguar red label on it. Daiwa Tatula SV, because the tube jig head I had was kind of lightweight. And I also have this set up on this rod. It's a slightly lighter rod and I can cast it real far. It's 8-to-1 gear ratio reel. The retrieve I did to catch that fish I did today on it was just casting it and sort of probing it over grass, because there was shallow grass, so I didn't want to just sit in grass and hang, because then the fish I felt like wouldn't have been able to pick it up out of the grass. So what I did instead of was casting it, let it hit the water, and then catching and getting tight before it hit the bottom, kind of probing up in the water column, it'd fall, and then like hop it again, almost like a crawfish, just going through the water column, fleeing. And that worked. I caught a 3.5 pounder on it, choked it, and I also caught a largemouth on this today. And I will note about the tube that both of the fish that ate the tube, or however many fish I ate the tube, at least two of them that ate the tube, absolutely had it in their gullet. I mean, in their throat. There was a lot of fish I caught this week that were very finicky with baits. Even the 4.5 pound largemouth I caught day one on that Senko, it didn't just swim over there and just oomph and just swim off with it. It landed, I casted past the fish, brought it sort of towards the fish, caught its attention, let it fall very slowly with the sink rate. They swam over to it and still stared at it for a minute, and then eventually just sipped it, just picked it up. So I will note, the tube, they actually smashed the tube. So that was kind of cool. But those are my four setups. That's what I use. Those are my retrieves. That's kind of how I did everything. I did use a ton of other setups in pre-fishing, a lot of great PAL sticks I put to work. Caught a bunch of great fish, a lot of 3-4 pound class fish. This place is amazing. First time ever on Lake Champlain, and I had a blast. So If you guys enjoy the video, make sure to like, comment, subscribe. I'm gonna be trying to get more tournament videos out soon, and I will try and fish all the Northern Toyotas this year. So stay tuned. Those are our four rods. That's what we did today. And now we have a 23 plus hour drive back home, give or take with stops. So it's gonna be longer with stops, but drive time is like 23 hours. So we're gonna head back home, gonna put these rods away, put the boat on the trailer, and that's all she wrote. See you in the next one, guys.